Good morning, everyone. My name is Vitor Vieira Vasconcelos, and today we will talk about sustainability development indicators in our course of development and sustainability. During this class, we will talk more generally about some points regarding sustainable development indicators. Then we will make a kind of historical perspective, starting with the Millennium Development Goals, then the Sustainable Development Goals that followed afterwards, like the Millennium Development Goals from 2002 to 2015, and then the Sustainable Development Goals that some call SDG from 2015 to 2030. And after that, I will discuss with you some alternative indexes, complementary ones, like the Living Planet Index, Planetary Boundaries, Environmental Performance Index, and Ecological Footprints. There are many, many, many others. Some very similar to each other. These ones that I selected to talk in the end of the class. I select them because they are conceptually interesting. They can bring some reflections that we can discuss later. And they are also like quite famous, so once in a while we see them, their reports here and there. So I think it would be good for you to know about them too. So first, in 1997, a group of researchers in the International Institute for Sustainable Development joined together and discussed in a long project review in many previous experiences of sustainable indicators, and they proposed some principles that would be important to think about when you think about sustainability indicators. First, they should provide us a guiding visions and goals, like what do we want for our future, what do we want to achieve. The sustainability indicators, they should provide a holistic perspective, so they should not be like separate process each indicator, but them together should be in a framework that shows how one relates to each other and gives a more general view, broader view of the aspect that you want to achieve. They need to be important, so they need to provide essential elements of, for example, the researchers propose like current and future inequality, resource use, overconsumption, poverty, human rights, access to services, ecological conditions, economic development, and also non-market activities that maybe are not incorporated in the national accounts, like the gross domestic product, but they contribute to well-being. And so you see, like, there are many ones, so it's difficult to select just one indicator that provide all these kinds of information that are important for sustainable development. They need to have an adequate scope, like they need to show how these characteristics differentiate in time, in space, and link the past with the future that you want to achieve. They need to have a practical focus, like they need to link what we can do to change, to achieve our objective. It's an indicator that we cannot do anything to change it, so why are we choosing it? And they should be limited, not so many indicators, because then you will risk losing your focus and working too much to update the indicators and not to change them. And it's important to be for them to be standardized, so they keep being measured in the same way in the past and in the future, and for every place that it's measured too. It's important then to be open and accessible for everyone, so everyone could look and monitor what is happening. It should be easy to communicate to people, so if it's a too complex indicator that no one understands, then it will not be useful. It's important to have a broad participation to select what will be the indicator, because the indicator people need to feel that they are represented in these indicators, that it's something that they want to achieve. If it's just one group and another one that's selected, then the other ones feel that they it's not related to them. So it's important to put everyone together and need to be an ongoing assessment. So you need to be keep monitoring, allocate resources to keep monitoring it from onwards, because if suddenly you stop monitoring it because you don't have money, then you lose the track. And it also helps like to select some indicators that we already have past records to know how it the trend in the past to the present. And we need to have institutional capacity to measure these indicators. We need to allocate resources to have professionals that will do that. So sometimes we would like very much to monitor something and we don't have capacity to monitor it, so we need to select other indicators. So all these principles together should give us what is important when we are selecting the sustainable ability indicator. Going more like to the historical part, I in this study that I'm showing you the graph, they divided the indicators into environmental, social, economic, and governance. We already talked in the past class about the triplet of sustainable development, environmental, social, and economic. And what we could start thinking when we look at this graph is like, are the sustainable development goals and indicators that were selected so far kind of balanced and showing all with the same focus all these aspects? And the governance is a little bit like how we will structure our institutional capacity or our cooperation among entities to achieve this goal. So we see that in Agenda 21, in 1992, in ECO 92 conference in Rio de Janeiro, there were like a lot of governance indicators, because it was the beginning of the process of sustainable discussions about sustainable development, and people were very concerned about how to achieve it, like, especially like we need to sign the international agreements, we need to put forward, like each country or each state should implement the local Agenda 21. So the governance were very important. And we see that the environmental indicators formed a quite big part of the list of indicators, and we have some social and economic ones too. And it's interesting to think that in the first conferences, like before 1992, the focus was mainly in the environmental aspects and a little bit in the economic one, but the social aspects were not so focused. Then in Agenda 21, it was this starting to appear more. And we see like in the other selections of indicators like Millennium Development Goals in 2002, it increased a lot and becomes much more social indicators than environmental ones that got just 4%. The governance indicators increased too, and the economic one decreased. Then, when they start to discuss what would be the new set of sustainability indicators or to start in 2015, there was a commission in United Nations, and they proposed like this balance of indicators here, like should be mainly 1/3 for each aspect and just 3% for governance. But after this first proposal, when it start the discussion with all the stakeholders, because the idea was to make a broad discussion and involve like government leaders and also like many institutions, NGOs all around the world, then in the end, The final set of indicators for sustainable development goals was this one, and we see that the social aspects increased even more than in the Millennium Development Goals, and the environmental indicators were like fewer than economic ones too. So this was the final set. Oh, think about all this historical perspective, like the increasing focus in social aspects. It's a little bit kind of polemical, like some authors, they criticize, some they say good things. The ones that criticize, they say like, as the social indicators increase their focus, the environmental aspect lost part of their focus. So the initial discussion about how the natural resources are decreasing, how the pollution is causing environmental problems, like health problems in people, our ethical aspects regarding the environment, all this became less important. And in the end, tracking these indicators became more like a kind of socioeconomic monitoring indicators in the end, and not involving so much the environmental part anymore. On the other hand, other authors, they argue that it was very important to include the social aspect, because many groups, many areas that didn't use this concept of sustainable development started using it again. For example, many groups in education policies, health policies, and other areas, they started to use this idea of meeting the needs of the current generation and also for the next one in the future. And it's a kind, you increase the dialogue. So even some people say, okay, now that there is the age of sustainable development because everyone is talking about it. So it's a little bit of this balance of what to give focus and how many people you want also to include in the debate, like from different areas. So we can say that the concept of sustainable development got wider, and it's good to involve more people, but it also becomes a little bit more vague concept, like something that is so broad that it's difficult to define and cannot have a very precise meaning. Like everyone says that one sustainable development, what is exactly that? So it's a little bit the challenge of you write so much, or you keep the focus in the environmental parts. That was the initial discussion. A little bit what I would like to show with this graph. Well, so from 2002 to 2015, there was this 8 Millennium Development Goals. Each one of these goals have like 3 or 2 to 4 indicators that show with precise goals of what we want to achieve in each indicators. So we have like to eradicate poverty and hunger, for education, for gender equality, child mortality, maternal health, fight against many diseases, and ensure environmental sustainability, and make a global partnership for development. So in 2015, there was a report of how much did we achieve in these goals. So we saw an improvement in all social goals, some of them more than others. Brazil achieved 7 objectives. It just didn't achieve maternal mortality goal from this 8, the one that it improved a little, but didn't achieve the goal that was set for Brazil. And both Brazil and the other countries in the world, most of people of countries have problem in achieving environmental goals. So it's a little bit what I would like to focus more in their rest of this class, like what if everything social is kind of improving, what was the problem with the environmental goals? And there is also a lot of subtle discussions about what would be the best way to select one environmental indicator or another one. And we will talk a little bit more about what was involved in these discussions too. Oh, for one of these environmental goal was about emissions of carbon dioxide that caused global warming. And in these graphs, we see that there is a here, especially like in the world, this lower one here, the emissions increased a long time. So it didn't improve, actually, it got worse. And it's especially because of developing regions, like the developed countries decreased a little bit, but the developing regions increased. And especially like in Eastern Asia, but a little bit also Southern Asia too. But Brazil specifically decreased the emissions because of halting deforestation in Amazon that decreased a lot. But deforestation in Amazon were the main cause of emission for Brazil. So Brazil went a little bit different of the trend that was happening in the rest of the world. Another indicator that was chosen was the ozone depleting substance that usually, for example, for refrigeration, that would emit these gases that decrease the ozone layer. And we see that in developed regions, but many years before the development goals were in 2002. They were already decreasing a lot, and then they further decreased more. And in the rest of the world, they also kept this trend of decreasing. So it's a kind of a success case that it's always shown, like how an international agreement is able to decrease the emission of something that is harming the environment. And we can think, okay, they chose this one because they already knew the trend in 2002 that the trend will be decreasing. If they have chosen like another kind of pollution, air pollution, they probably would see it increasing. So there is this thing about what you choose, because you choose something that is already decreasing, so you expect that by the end of 2015, you will have something good to tell other people too. It's important to think about this. Other indicators were not so much successful. So we see here in this graph about the fish stocks, like in the ocean, the amount of fish, and we see that it kept decreasing along all this time since the 90s until 2015. And we see what happened with the fish catches, like how it increased the amount of fish that they were catching in the ocean. And then after 1995, it started to decrease, and it shows that actually we started to get more fish that the ocean was able to recover after we collect the fish. That's why the fishing production started to decrease. So it's an indicator that got worse along this time. There is another indicator that the amount of the terrestrial areas that are protected, and the indicators show how it increased. Like in the world, we see here that it increased through each year. And they say, oh, so it's a case of success. Yes, in these indicators, yes, it increased. But then I will like to make another reflection with you too. Like, why were protected areas the chosen indicators, and they didn't choose indicators like native vegetation or deforestation, for example? Would you think why they did not choose that ones? Well, if you think that if they choose native vegetation or deforestation, they would show the opposite trend, like that native vegetation keeps decreasing along all these times. The deforestation keeps going and even increasing a long time. So you will not have a kind of successful indicators in them. So I would like to you to keep paying attention, like why they select one or didn't select other indicator in each moment. Another indicator was the proportion of people with improved sanitation, and by this concept of improved sanitation, it's especially people you have like collection of the sewage at your house, so you don't have contact with the sewage when it goes out of your house. And it increased in many countries. In the most, in the poorest countries, it didn't achieve the goals that were set, they increased. But for example, in Sub-Saharan Africa and Oceania, it increased very little instead of what was proposed to achieve. And it has to do a lot with lack of funds, lack of international funds that should be donated by the developed countries in this agreement in 2002 and didn't reach these countries. But in general, we could say that it increased in developing regions towards this time. And well, then it's important to think that to not have contact with sewage helps a lot to decrease a lot many diseases that would be transmitted to sewage. But I would like to make another reflection with you too. For example, why was sanitary sewage chosen and not sewage treatment, for example? Because with sanitary sewage, you put the sewage in the pipe, the water that is used in the house in the pipe, bring it away from the city, and then you put directly into the river, and you keep causing the environmental impact in the rivers. And I would say that the environmental impact is even a little bit higher, because if it is a kind of diffuse pollution, like a little bit here, a little bit there, then the aquatic environment is a little bit more able to cope with that. But when you put like all this sewage together reaching to the river, then it's a great environmental impact, and then you disturb everything and you kill almost all the living beings in the water. So this selection of why you choose one and the other, first you could think like, well, it's much cheaper to do the sanitary sewage pipes than to do the treatment. So especially for developing countries, they kind of prioritize this measure than the treatment. And another thing is that, like, what is the focus of what you want to achieve? For example, if you go to an anthropocentric ethics, like focusing human beings, then okay, you are with sanitary sewage, you are decreasing the disease in humans. So you are achieving your goals, like put the sewage away from humans. Of course, sometimes it's a little bit difficult because one city throws the sewage, and then there is another city a little bit downwards, downstream, and then the other city needs to kind of try to isolate, cover the rivers, not let people get near the rivers because it's polluted. But you keep trying to avoid the contact of people with the polluted water as a way to improve health. But, and on the other hand, you are not having what we call ecocentric ethics, that you are not caring about the other living beings that are being damaged with the pollution. So the choice of one indicator or the other shows what you are caring more about. And this is an important aspect that I would like to show with you about this indicator. Well, then in 2015, there was a new set of development goals. Now you see that they increased, not only 8, we have 17. And each one of these indicators, now if each one of these goals, sorry, they have many indicators inside each one. So in the end, you will have like hundreds of indicators, proposed ones. You have like regarding poverty, hunger, health, education, gender, sanitation, sustainable energy, economic development, smart cities, reduce inequalities, efficient production, combating climate, preserving biodiversity, both aquatic and terrestrial ones, and also like achieving peace and justice for everyone and human right, defending their human rights. And the last one is the governance one, that is to make cooperation to achieve all these other goals. Just to show you a little bit of how it happened, I will provide you a short video of United Nations promoting the Sustainable Development Goals that was released at that time, and then you will be able to feel a little bit the climate of the Sustainable Development Goal. Okay, so let's go.
The United Nations General Assembly was the scene of a celebration in 2015, when 193 member countries adopted the Sustainable Development Goals, a unanimous commitment to end poverty, fight inequality, and tackle climate change.
We need action from everyone, everywhere. 17 Sustainable Development Goals are our guide. They are a to-do list for people and planet, and the blueprint for success.
The SDGs are an agenda to balance human prosperity with protecting the planet.
Imagine there's no countries.
UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador Shakira asked global leaders to imagine a world where we achieve the goals by 2030. While fellow UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador Angelique Kidjo underscored a focus on Africa and developing countries. But the universal agenda is important to all nations, as leaders from developed countries also pledged to make the goals a reality.
Poverty, growing inequality exists in all of our nations, and all of our nations have work to do, and that includes here in the United States. And that's why today I am committing the United States to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals.
The Sustainable Development Goals build on the success of another 15-year plan. Created in the year 2000, the Millennium Development Goals sunset at the end of 2015. The MDGs halved extreme poverty, achieved equal primary education for girls and boys, and dropped HIV infection by 40%, among many successes. The SDGs go beyond the MDGs by improving the lives of everyone, everywhere, and create a better world for future generations.
Today, we are 193 young people representing billions more.
The youngest Nobel Peace Laureate, Malala, calls on world leaders to keep their promise to every child.
Each lantern we hold represents the hope we have for our future because of the commitments you have made to the global goals.
And Pope Francis advised world leaders to put humanity and the environment over politics.
Los gobernantes han de hacer todo lo posible a fin de que todos puedan tener la mínima base material y espiritual para ejercer su dignidad y para formar y mantener una familia.
193 nations unanimously committed to the Sustainable Development Goals.
It is so decided.
But the journey starts here. Now's the time to take global action for local results and move our people and planet towards a sustainable future.
What I would like to emphasize in this video that you just watched is how there is this kind of marketing or advertising or like this effort from United Nations to use these sustainable development goals to stimulate the countries to invest in these goals that seem to be important for people. So besides all this criticism that I provide you towards this class, it's important also to think like why are they choosing to make these goals? Why is it important? Like, it's a kind of campaign to give like a wide view of what we would like to achieve and help the and try to convince the government leaders to invest like their resources, their money in these topics, in these aspects that are considered important. We discussed in a previous class about the concepts of weak and strong sustainability. So this figure shows a little bit how we could interpret the sustainable development goals within this framework of strong sustainability. I don't know if you remember, like there was the ecological ones, and then inside the society and inside the economy. And we can distribute the indicators in each one of these circles, biosphere, society, and economy. We see that there are less goals related to environment and many more regarding society. But what I would like to show in this graph is about this idea that if this layer is bad, this outer circle is bad, then you bring damage to the inner one. And also, you cannot grow the economy forever because there is a limit. It cannot go further than the outer layer, the outer circles too. So it's a little bit of, you cannot just make a trade-off or grow one of them forever in the expense of the other one. In the next slides, I will focus a little bit more in the environmental ones, in the biosphere, because actually, if we see the other indicators, it will be like the economic ones are always increasing sharply. The ones for social aspects are increasing a little bit, like in a slower rate, but they are increasing. But in the biosphere one, the environmental ones, some increase, some decrease. And there is a lot of discussion, criticism, like why are we not achieving them? So we will focus a little bit more on them. So about the fisheries stocks, we already showed and discussed it in the Millennium Development Goals. I put this graph just to show the updated trend. Like after 2015, it keeps decreasing. So it's getting even worse for a long time. And there is this identification of marine dead zones, and especially are in rivers, like near the coast, when the rivers reach the ocean and there's a river that is very polluted, not only sewage, but especially for fertilizers in agriculture. And when all these nutrients reach the ocean, it causes what we call algal bloom, like a lot of algae growing. And then the oxygen levels decrease so low that kills almost all other living beings, like the fishes and molluscs and all other living beings that would be near this coast. So we see that there are a lot of dead zones in Eastern United States and other Northern Europe, but we also have along all the coasts in the world, especially next to populated areas. Another indicator was the protected marine areas. And we see here these blue ones in the oceans are the areas that are protected. They are increasing little by little. And nowadays it's 7.4% of the ocean. What I would like to discuss about them, because the main reason for these marine areas is to provide places that the fish can reproduce and recover the fishery stocks along the world, but we see that it's still not enough because the fishery stocks are still decreasing. So we would need like much wider protected marine areas to be able to reach a sustainable reproduction of the fisheries and recover what we are taking out from the ocean. So it's still not enough. Going now to the land, they now from 2015 they put the land covered by forests, so they didn't put just the protected areas. So we see like there in Brazil especially, we see that there is a decrease in forested areas towards the last decades. In the world too, but in a lower rate, like from 33% to 31%, and Brazil is decreasing much faster than the rest of the world, especially because there are some countries that already deforested everything in the past, so they don't have so much to deforest anymore. And then I would like also that we could think about another reflection. Like, what about the non-native forest ecosystems? Weren't they important? So there was indicator for forest and not for the other ones. For example, the savannas, the grasslands. And why not? Would you think? Why not? Well, one of the reasons is because it's difficult to do monitor it. For forest nowadays, we can use satellite imagery, and it's quite easy when you have the forest and you have the deforestation. It changes the color of the satellite image very sharply. So you can map it and quantify it easily. But for grasslands and savannas, it's not so easy to distinguish what is a native area and what is pasture, for example, or some kind of agriculture that keep changing. It's not like so dense like a forest. So it's a little bit more challenge to monitor it. But I will tell you that nowadays we have already technology try to guess how they are being destroyed to this non-forest ecosystem. Would have less certainty, but it would be possible to make an effort to do that. But why it was not chosen even so? Well, there is another aspect that we can think like, well, that's usually like a much like strong flag to defend the forest than the other ecosystems. Like there are not so many NGOs, for example, striving to protect the savannas or the grasslands, but it's much higher concern, like we see in the news, in the debates about the forest, like Amazon, Atlantic Forest. So, it calls more attention. So the choice of indicator also shows like what we give more importance in the end too. And the sad part is that, well, probably at least for the savannas and grassland, there's much more expansion of agriculture in the non-forest ecosystems in the previous years than in the forest ones. And they are not being monitored. So the savannas, like what we call Cerrado in Brazil, or even the Caatinga, that is a kind of savanna in the northeast, they are giving space to the expansion of agriculture, and all this biodiversity is risking to disappear because of this. And it's a little bit like that. What you don't monitor, you don't protect so much. You keep giving less attention. And then things may go worse and you don't even know in the end. It's a kind of cycle, like monitoring and protection and value that you give to it too. This other indicator show the percentage of selected important biodiversity sites that are protected. Look that it's kind of different from the in the Millennium Development Goals, that is the total area of that is protected. Here, there is a kind of list of sites provided by some studies of NGOs like IUCN, International Union for the Conservation of Nature, that show like what are the most important sites for biodiversity in the world. And then indicators show the percentage of them that are protected. So we see that it has increased a little bit since 2000 until now, but it's kind of reaching a kind of plateau, both in Brazil and in the world. So we are not, it was increasing before and now it's kind of stable, it's not increasing anymore. We are not seeing like so many new important areas being protected. And we see also that before Brazil was a little bit better than the average in the world, but the rest of the world increased faster than Brazil, and now it's almost similar. And well, then we could think about other reflection, like why wasn't percentage of protected area in relation to the total area of the country chosen? Why did they put like in relation to important sites for biodiversity? What do you think? Well, in some aspect, something that could be argued in favor of this indicator is that not every area in the world is equally important for biodiversity, so you focus more in what is important. But on the other hand, it hides a little bit this fact that in most developed countries, there are very little biodiversity sites that are worth to preserve because they already occupied most of it already in the past. So much of these important biodiversity sites are in developing countries. So you kind of focus on that, and the developed country, if they preserve just some very small areas that are still remaining there, they already achieve a very high rate in this indicator. Oh, it's a little bit what we see here in this map showing how each country is going with this indicator. So, for example, in Europe, we have just a few conservation areas, but they are the only ones that are lasting there. So they achieve a very high rate in this indicator. On the other hand, for example, in China or in Brazil, you have relatively lower because you have a lot of important sites, and then you measure like how it's, for example, if there are very large areas in Amazon, and then you to protect that you would make need to make a very large conservation park, for example. Oh, another aspect that first I showed you important areas from biodiversity in land, like the terrestrial biodiversity. And we also show like marine, but there is also these freshwater biodiversity sites and areas that are important for the reproduction, for example, of fisheries and other living beings in the water. And they are also like important for birds that nidify in this area that like this kind of freshwater areas too. And we see that in the world, it's increasing a long time. But in Brazil, it's quite stable. It's increasing very little. And it shows like in Brazil, there is much stronger concern about terrestrial biodiversity. And this kind of freshwater important sites, they didn't receive so much attention, but we have them. For example, Pantanal, we have Lagoa dos Patos. We have many areas in Amazon that are constantly kind of waterlogged, like the kind of swamp or flooded forest, for example, and they are not being protected so much as with the same focus as the terrestrial ecosystem. And maybe it's something that Brazil needs to improve in the future. So here I'm showing you the map of protected areas in the world. Here, focusing just what we call integral protection, that are areas that are really protected, that you cannot deforest anymore. You cannot convert to another, to a tropic like agriculture or pasture. There are other kinds of protected areas that we call sustainable use, that they can be converted. They just have like a higher surveillance or mechanism to achieve like sustainable production. Yeah, I was just trying to show like what areas that are really like reserved for protection of biodiversity. And we can see that there are some like in Africa, in the forests of Africa, and some in the forests of Latin America, South America, little bit like in the not in Canada and Australia too. But in many areas of the world, you have very few protected areas like China, India, Europe, Eastern United States, Central America. It's still like lacking a lot of protection. Another indicator that is used often is the Red List Index that shows like how the species are threatened but for extinction. And usually we see in this map like the brighter parts are the one that you have less species facing risk of extinction comparing with the proportion of species that you have in these places. And we see it, for example, that in Eastern Africa and Southeastern South Asia and Central America, we have like the highest rate. And usually in the most northern area, you will have less problem because you don't have like so much biodiversity. You have like this kind of boreal forest or temperate forest that you have the same species in a very large area. So you don't cause so much extinction if you occupy some areas, but in tropical regions, you have a lot of biodiversity and endemic for certain place. So if you destroy this place, you endanger like many species that do not exist in other places. And especially in areas that are being more occupied nowadays, like where you have a lot of population pressure, then you have more or more like expansion of agriculture, then you have more threatened species, especially in tropical areas. So we see like the same indicators now through time, not in the map anymore. And we see that in the world, it's decreasing faster than in Brazil. And Brazil is a little bit higher, better situation than the rest of the world about this in this aspect. But it's also going downwards too, or getting worse. Here, we kind of divide what we saw here as a general index for species for many different kinds of species. And then we see that they face different challenges. For example, corals are decreasing a lot because of global warming and acidification of the oceans. And you are having like a lot of extinction in coral species. For the main groups of birds, mammals, and amphibians, we have a decreasing, but it's not so sharp a long time. For cycads, that is a special kind of plants, we see that it's already quite low. They are like much more threatened, and they are decreasing. Like among birds, mammals, and amphibians, the amphibians are in the lowest level, and I will discuss a little bit more about the cycads later. But we have many other kinds of living being that we don't have knowledge, we don't have information if they are decreasing or not. We have just like one assessment in some moment in time and just that. And for example, vegetables, molluscs, snails, reptiles, we don't know if they are decreasing or increasing. We just one assessment. We have a lot of lack of information about them. For insects in general, we don't even know like anything. And so it shows like how much we still need to know to understand what is happening with the ecosystem. Just to bring this photo of the cycads, it's kind of, probably you have seen this kind of plants in some gardens or some yard somewhere, some parks, ornamental landscapes, like you have like they have this very distinct kind of leaves and log too, and stem. And why they are so threatened if we see them quite often? Well, especially because of exploration of nature, like many places, people go to native ecosystem, get all these cycads and bring to sell for ornamental landscapes. And many of these cycads, they are endemic to islands. You have like an island that have just this kind of cycad, and this species just lives there in any other island. So you go to the boat there, get all the species, bring to other place to sell in other places, and then these species is extinct in native ecosystems. So some of them you will see just in the garden, some of them does not exist anymore. And so it's just show an example of how a specific group of animals may face a very hard challenge with the development, human development. Well, I showed you some indicators separately, but there is this kind of integrated indicator that shows in overall how each country is performing regarding the development goal. And we see here that in Europe is performing better, and in Africa is performing worse. In other developing region, it's like half the way intermediary values, and including North America, intermediary values. So it's a kind of ranking of how the countries are performing. But for that, it's important to keep in mind what we talked in the beginning of the class, that the highest focus of most of the goals are social goals. So if the country is achieving its social goals, then it will give a more overall performance in the index, even if the environmental indicators are not going so well because there are just few ones. So we need to keep that in mind. Like what we see in the aggregated form doesn't show exactly what is happening in each group. And we also have a few countries in Africa that are great that we don't have information to measure. So we don't know, we cannot say what is happening there. One thing that is interesting in this index is that it doesn't take into account just what is happening in the country, but also the impact that the country is causing in another countries. For example, if it's importing natural resources from other countries and causing impact in the country that is extracting. So there is a kind of adjustment in this index to decrease the level of sustainability achievement. This is what we call here spillover effect. So the brightest ones next to white are the ones that are being like more deduction because they are causing impact in other countries when they import their goods, and the darker ones are the ones that do not have so much change on it. So we see that especially developed countries, richer countries, they are causing more impacts in other countries by the consumption chain. So there is what we call spillover of the environmental impact. Here we see the countries ranked in this graph by GDP per capita, like the richer ones here are on the right, the poorest on the left, and the adjustment for the spillover effect here. So we see that there is this kind of, the richer is the country, more they have the spillover. For example, Switzerland, they get like 30% of what they would, if there was no spillover, they would reach a level. Then there is adjustment to get like to 30% because they cause a very high impact on other countries. And of course there is difference between each country, like how they have like the energy supply, they assume a more sustainable lifestyle or not, and there is this kind of difference. But we see like this trend, like of richer countries causing more impact in other countries to this spillover. We can also explore like country by country in this type of sustainable development indicators. We see, for example, Brazil ranks at 61 in 165 countries. And in Latin, we could say like from 0 to 100, Brazil gets this achievement of 76% of the development goal. And if we adjust it just for Latin America, Brazil is like on 71, like it's higher than the average. The average is 68 in Latin America. Brazil is a little bit higher than the average in Latin America. And we can also check like goal by goal. So we see that there are some goals that Brazil is performing better, some Brazil is performing worse. If we see here in this graph, the lowest bar is about the reduction of inequality that Brazil is very far from achieving. So Brazil have this very high problem, big problem of social inequality, and doesn't seem to be going towards solving these problems. So it's where we are performing lower. In other indicators like eradication of poverty, clean and affordable energy, and climate, Brazil is not so bad, because in the last decades, Brazil took out many people from the poverty line, and the energy in Brazil is a lot about based on hydropower, which is a renewable energy. It's better than other countries that relies a lot more, much more in fossil fuels and nuclear energy. And about climate, I already talked with you that it's a lot related about the deforestation in Amazon in Brazil. As long as we maintain it lower, Brazil would achieve a good place in climate. But if it gets worse, then we will risk to decrease it in the future too. And there is a dashboard for each country that shows like what are development goals that are being achieved, which and the ones that are not being achieved, and what is the trend. So the color that we see in each one of the goals shows how is the situation now. So the green ones are the ones that are already achieved, the yellow and orange like kind of middle of the way, and the red ones are the ones that are not good in this moment. And we see that the most of biodiversity is not going well, economic development, health, inequality that we already told, and sustainable production, they are not quite good. And we also see that even the trend, like this one that have this line, like horizontal ones, shows like they are not improving. They are not showing improvement. The ones that have it's like a little bit inclined, they are improving slowly, and the ones that are high, they are improving in a good rate that probably we will achieve it. So we see that we are going better, in improving better, just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them, and we are not seen to improve so much in the other ones. Health, like a slower, a little bit in sustainable communities, a little bit, but for example, biodiversity, justice, inequality. Inequality is not even measuring, because we postpone our census. We don't know what is happening with inequality. We need to do our next census to understand what if it increased or not. And like economic growth in Brazil since the recession 2015 is not going very well. So we see like, and sustainable production, we don't have like data enough. So we see that things are not going very well in this goal for Brazil. Like there are many challenges that we need to face to improve them. Another topic that I would like to talk with you is that many researchers are showing now that there are trade-offs between these sustainable development goals, and they show it by monitoring, by simulation, that if you make choices to increase one of them, then it may decrease other ones. And then it's quite complex to achieve like an overall balance of these trade-offs. And especially if you think about the weak sustainability, like that you can make this compensation easily, then okay, one is increasing, the other one is not decreasing so much, so you make this choice. But when you go to the strong sustainability that you need to keep some, almost all the indicators, at least at some level, to not disrupt the harmony, the equilibrium of the system, then it's become a much more difficult challenge. For example, if you choose to the installation of projects, for example, industry, mining, hydropower, that is a strategy for economic growth in a country. So probably you will have improvement in the economic and social indicators, but these projects will cause environmental impacts, and then the environmental indicators will get worse. I'm not saying that it will always get, but it's a kind of trend, general trend that happens in general. And then there is this problem that we already discussed, like what is happening in the world. The economic and social indicators are improving, but the indicators of environment, they are kind of going lower, do not show like that things are improving, mainly because of that, of these choices of the countries. But usually in this kind of study, they point like that there are some alternatives that the governments can do to achieve a better, at least a relatively better development. For example, if you invest in education, in health, and in technology that is more efficient in the use of natural resources and cause less pollution, you increase your production efficiency. And with that, you will have improvement in the economic and social indicators, and the environmental indicators will not get worse. For example, people will work better, or they have more education, more health, use less natural resources. So it does not improve the environmental indicators usually, but at least it does not get worse. So this study shows how it's important to invest in education, health, and eco-efficiency technology. So now going further than the sustainable development goals, I would like to discuss some other indicators with you. One then is the Living Planet Index. It's focused in biodiversity, especially like vertebrate animals, because are the ones that we have more information. And they show like how is the trend of extinction, of declining trend in each taxonomy of each kind of animal. And it also assesses the uncertainty that we have, because we don't have all the information, all the knowledge about what is happening in all ecosystems too. Here we see the challenges for different kinds of animals, different taxonomies, and what is causing their extinction. So we see that for most of them, it's the habitat degradation or loss, like the pollution, the deforestation, that is causing the decline, because they don't have like the place that they need to live. But for different taxonomies, it's changed a little bit, like the extension of how it's important. And the second one is exploitation. And especially for fish, it's even higher than habitat degradation that is causing more threatening problems for the fish species. And there is also like another cause, like invasive species, disease, pollution, climate change, that have smaller effect, but they have some, but it's also different for each taxonomy. For example, mammals, they can adapt more to climate change because they regulate the internal temperature, and birds too, but the birds have a problem that it may change like the characteristics of the places that they used to migrate from different areas in different seasons. The seasons may change, the weather and the ecosystem, then they cannot get the food that they need. And for fish and reptiles and amphibians, like, they cannot regulate so much their internal temperature. So if the temperature changes, they may get extinct. They cannot adapt so much to it. So usually this index, it makes a baseline in 1970, how it was at that time, and show like how things are getting worse. And it in 2016, that was the last calculation, it was like minus 68%. Comparing to what was in the 70s. And this line, now this kind of buffer between the lines shows the uncertainty. So it may be a little bit higher, a little bit lower, but we know that there is this general trend of decreasing. The ecosystems, the biodiversity is getting more threatened towards time. Here we see what is happening in each region of the world. And we see that in Latin America is the worst declining trend. Things are getting worse through time. And less, for example, in North America, North Asia. And it has to do with what I told you before, that there are less species in temperate areas, so the risk to, and they are not so much endemic for just one region, so they face less risk when you have the deforestation. But it's still declining in every place in the world. Africa is and Asia, Oceania, they are decreasing too, but not so sharply as in Latin America. Another framework of index that is very famous is the planetary boundaries, that it shows like how some environmental problems are going further than the limit that the planet could hold. So we see like there are all these indicators here in these circles, and the ones that cross this a darker line here and start to become red are the ones that are like disrupting like more than the planet could afford and could maintain its equilibrium. So do we see that the more difficult problems in the world, the biggest problems are regarding the biochemical fluxes here, that is the emission of phosphorus and nitrogen, especially for fertilization. And we see that they cause pollution not only in the water, the dead zones that we saw, but also for nitrogen, there is the atmospheric emission too. And we also have here the genetic diversity that we already saw like in the Living Planet Index, how the rate of extinction is much higher than the natural rate of the planet. So it's something that it's degrading the quality of the ecosystems. We have other ones that are increasing, but it's not crossed the level yet. But if we don't take care, they may cross the level that is changing the systems, for example, deforestation, climate change for global warming, depletion of the ozone layer that is not so complex now. We saw that the pollution is decreased a lot, and acidification of the oceans, that we see that it's increasing, but it's causing the problems in coral areas, but they're in general for the planet, it's still in levels that may still not so high. In many areas of the world, it's still like stable. And we also have freshwater use that is increasing, but still we have some to use. And there are some indicators that we don't have knowledge of what is happening. For example, novel pollutants are pollutants that we are emitting, but we don't know how very well the effect on our health. And we also don't know how to take them out of the environment to clean them. For example, One of these novel pollutants that are being discussed nowadays, we don't know all of them. We keep like discovering new ones all the time. For example, there is the estrogen, like that women, they emit in the urine, like especially when they take pills for birth control. And they go into the sewage. We don't have efficient treatment to remove them for the water. And then they cause a lot of impacts on this hormone. They cause a lot of impacts in the life in the water and also for human beings that drink this water. And especially for males, like both animals and humans, that they cannot deal very well with estrogen. We also have the degradation of plastic that brings a lot of these pollutants in the water. And we are facing it like this problem in many places in the world, especially in the metropolitan region of São Paulo. In the ABC region, we have the tailings and other kinds of reservoirs that the research is showing that these novel pollutants are there and they are causing all these problems too. For example, other things that we don't know yet, for example, the effect of the increase in atmospheric aerosols, that is the dust in the atmosphere, and how it will change climate, for example. And we have here the functional diversity here at the side of genetic diversity, because we know that fishes are getting extincted in a very fast rate. But usually, for example, if you one species of bird disappear, then sometimes another species of bird kind of takes its place in the ecosystem and makes the start to perform the role that this other species that got extincted would do in this ecosystem. Then the ecosystem keeps a little bit balanced and keeps stable. But there are some moments when you keep like taking out species, there is a moment that you will take one species that cannot be replaced. And then all the ecosystem, the balance of the ecosystem will disrupt. And we don't know when it will happen in each ecosystem. And sometimes we guess that there are some species like big mammals or large predators, that if you take them out, it will cause a very drastic change in the ecosystem, because you don't have any other animal or any other living being to get its place. But it's something that we still don't know. And the idea about this question marks here is that something that it's important to invest more research and to start monitoring it too, because it may disrupt the planetary harmony, planetary equilibrium, and we don't even know like how. Well, there is another index that is linked to the previous one called Environmental Performance Index. It aggregates different indicators of sustainable development, but instead of giving the same weight to each one, like we saw in the Sustainable Development Index, it gives different weight based on some. So it divides in two dimensions. One is environmental health, that is the influence in human health. So it gives more weight to the indicators based on what they cause in human health. And the other one is ecosystem vitality, that based on the equilibrium of the ecosystem. So 40% of the indicator is environmental health. That would be like what we would think like the anthropocentric part of the indicator, and has to do with air quality, water quality, have exposure to heavy metal, that's a kind of important kind of pollution. And all these aspects are divided in many indicators: sanitation, drinking water, particulate materials. What is not so common so much more in urban areas, but in countries that have a lot of people in rural areas, that's people that have this kind of stove that you put the wood inside the stove. And it caused a lot of smoke that people keep breathing inside their homes too. So it causes health problems too. And we have also the ecosystem vitality, that 60% would be the kind of ecocentric dimension. And then it has many indicators, but they are also weighted based on the planetary boundaries. So the indicators that would cause more effect regarding the disruption of the equilibrium in the ecosystem, they are given more weight too. And then here we see each dot is one country and how they perform in the ecosystem vitality indicator and environmental health. And we see that there is a kind of trend, but with a lot of dispersion. And each color is one area of the globe, one region. So most of the developed countries are here, and countries in Africa are here, and here like Latin America and Asia. And what they kind of show in this and discuss in these reports of this index is that the richer countries in developed countries, they are being able to decrease pollution and environmental degradation better than poorest countries that actually, they, besides being poor, they are not able to control the pollution and degradation of the ecosystem that are getting worse from time to time. And it's causing more health problems to people too. So here is the GDP, gross domestic product, and the aggregated environmental performance index. So this one is the kind of 40% environmental health and 60% ecosystem vitality. And then we see that when you increase income of people, you are increasing the environmental performance too. So like the biggest challenge is about environmental performance is in the poorest countries nowadays. And here is how each one perform. Then we can see clear like richer countries, Europe, North America, Australia, Japan, they have a better environmental performance, and Africa and South Asia is in a worse situation. Latin America and rest of Asia in an intermediary situation. The last indicator that I would like to discuss is called ecological footprint. Then there is this picture of the step of humanity on Earth. It's a little bit the idea that we want to show with this indicator. How much land do we need on Earth to give us our what we need, and then to use this land we need to cause degradation of the native areas of the planet. So it's calculated like that for each person here. How much land is needed to provide everything that the person needs? For example, need wood, then needs to use forest. Need emit global warming gases, greenhouse gases. So you need to compensate planting some area so that the vegetation will grow and extract the carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. And this area specifically of greenhouse is related to what we call carbon footprint, that is related to global warming. Then we have pasture, cropland for food, area, built area for living, fishing area to extract fish, and so on. And a concept that is complementary to the ecological footprint is the biocapacity, that what is the amount of area that we have in the planet to be footprinted. So it's not all the area of the planet. It's estimated that it's just 22% of the planet that can be used, because most of the ocean does not have enough food, like fish, that would be useful to produce food. Just usually just in the border of the continent that you have nutrients enough for the fish to reproduce. So it's just 4% of the ocean. In the land also, we have a lot of land that is desert, that is ice, and that is degraded land that cannot be used. And we have just some part of the land, 18% of biological productive land in the globe. So this is what we have to, we can use. So here in this map, we see the average footprint per person. And we see that how many hectares we each person would need, and we see that in North America is the highest one, and but we also have high ones in Middle Orient, Australia, and Asia too. And the we saw here in the previous one that we have 1.8 hectares per person. If we each person use 1.8, is already the limit of what we our planet can provide. And we see like it, most of many countries already passed, they have more than 1.7 here. Just this one that are very clear in Africa and South Asia, and some in Oceania, Australasia, they still have lower ecological footprint than what would be sustainable in the planet. Some of them like are more like than 6 hectares, so it's quite higher than what we the planet could provide. So we see also in the previous map how there is this inequality. Some people are eating too much of the count of the planet, and some people don't have anything. And we can make also some kind of balance between the footprint of each country and the biocapacity, the amount of land that this country can use to provide these needs. And we see here in this map that the red ones are the ones that are already consuming more that they can provide with their own land. And the green, and we call it biocapacity debtors. And the green ones are the ones that have more land than their footprint, so they are kind of creditors, because actually they are using their lands to provide the goods that the other countries are needing. So they are kind of exporting their production, their insumes to fulfill the needs of other countries that already have much, like are consuming much more than they can produce. And another way to interpret the ecological footprint is think about the number of planets that were needed, would be needed if everyone in the world imitate the lifestyle of that country. So for example, if we everyone in the world start to use the same lifestyle as in the United States, then we will need more than 4 planets. And actually just these green countries here are the ones that if we would imitate them, we would need less than 1 planet. So it's just to think about this idea here that thinking about our planet as our house, this house is already too small for what we are needing. We cannot, it's too small planet for what we are doing now. And here it shows like a long time what is changing the ecological footprint within 2 decades, this specific study. And it shows like the red ones are the ones that the ecological footprint increased more a long time. And the green ones are places that where the ecological footprint decreased. And we see like more, it matches like the countries that still have a relatively small footprint, but they are kind of increasing because they are developing and producing more and increasing their consumption. And we see here, specifically in Brazil, in the southeast of Brazil, where it has also been increasing a lot to the ecological footprint. And well, here we see in this graph how the ecological footprint changed in groups of countries, so lower income, middle, lower income, and average income and high income. So in general, the ecological footprint increased in all the countries, but it increased more in lower income and especially in middle lower income countries, that they increase more the ecological footprint. Especially like you see, like people, countries where people were not used to eat so much meat, and then they start to eat meat and in higher level, which is maybe important for their nutrition, but it also causes more environmental impact too. Here we see what is happening with the ecological footprint a long time, from the 60s to 2017. That is the last year that we have measurement. And we see, like, at the top of the graph, like how it's increasing. This line here, blue line, is the limit of one planet. So we see, like, after the 70s, it's already extrapolated more than one planet. And the highest footprint would be about carbon, like the land that would be needed to restore, to become carbon neutral, like to recover the amount of carbon that we are emitting in the atmosphere. And the other ones, like agriculture, pasture, built area, and forest products. And well, we could think also, like, okay, so you look to this graph and you think, okay, so I will not care anymore about global warming, let the planet get warmer, and let's think about their other aspects. So summing up all the other aspects, it still hasn't achieved one planet, but it's increasing. And the moment where it reaches one planet without the carbon footprint, then we will have a very hard time, because there will be no land anymore to expand agriculture, to expand pasture. If you increase, like, expand the built area, you will do in expense of other productive areas, and then the situation will be much harder for humanity. And also, one aspect that is important that I would like to think with you is that the ecological footprint is a kind of anthropocentric indicators, because we are thinking all the resource for humans. And another aspect that is important, for example, in this graph here is the white area. Actually, this white area should be the native ecosystems that they are being degraded towards the time. So, like, we need more land for human needs, and then when you increase this productive area, you are destroying the native ecosystem. So we also could think about the other side of the ecological footprints, like you eat more meat than you the grasslands are destroying the ecosystem in Amazon, and then you are actually decreasing the space for other living beings. So here we have a graph for individual countries, in this case for Brazil, and we see that since the 60s to most recent time, the ecological footprint has not increased so much in Brazil, just a little bit. And it has to do, like, okay, we are consuming more, but we are also becoming more efficient in our production. For example, our production is using less natural resource, less land. You, for example, can produce more cattle and produce more vegetables in less land, for example. But even so, look what is happening with our biocapacity. That is the amount of land that we have to for use for each person. It's decreasing. And why? Why do you think it's decreasing? You can think. I give you some moments to think about it. Well, one thing that you may think, okay, can be for because of population growth. You have more people, so you have less land for each person. And it may be one of the reasons, especially in the beginning here, when there was still like higher population growth in Brazil. Now it's becoming more stable. And I think more like towards the end here, it has a lot to do with what we are using of our land to export to other countries. We saw like that graph that Brazil is a kind of predator. So we are using the land to export goods, to produce meat and veg and grains and vegetables to other countries, and then we have less land available to use for our own needs too. And in the moment that the biocapacity goes below the ecological footprints, then we would become debtors, then we will need to import resources from other countries. If there is another country that still has something to export, it may reach a point that there is not anymore. Here in this graph, we see the ecological footprint per person in each country. Here in this vertical line, and this horizontal line is the Human Development Index, and we have like the region, each region in different colors. So we have more like here North America and Europe, and here more Africa, and here more like Asia, Latin America, and we see that after a certain point in Human Development Index, we can think about it goes like kind of stable, and then it starts to increase and go increasing after a certain line. And here, this line that we have in this graph, here is the world capacity in the 60s and the world biocapacity in 2040. So the ecological footprint should be built. We would like it to be below this line here. So we see that there are some countries that are still, but most of the countries are above. And here is the poverty line, like the human development line, that is the goal for United Nations to have all these the countries to go through this side of this line. And here is very high developed. So the idea would be go to the right of this line and lower than this line. And we see there are very few countries that managed to do it here. And then I would like you to think, can you guess what countries are these ones that got like a relatively higher level of human development, but with lower ecological footprints? Because they could be like our example that we could try to follow, like to be an example for all the world, like what, how should we behave? So there are these ones, above 6, an ecological footprint below global biocapacity: Algeria, Colombia, Ecuador, Georgia, Jamaica, Jordan, and Sri Lanka. So quite different, no, than the ones that we would usually think as a reference for sustainability. Many people would think, it should be in Europe, where they are advancing a lot in more eco-efficient technologies and are high human development. But actually, they have very high ecological footprint. So these are the countries that that in this relationship, they are getting better. And there is just one that is above 0.7 in Human Development Index, that is Cuba. And well, we can kind of imagine that, like Cuba, they have a very good internal organization, like people, everyone has access to good better education and health services, very little inequality. And but at the same time, they consume very little. And but we can think, okay, is their choice to consume very little, or it's because of the economic blockage that United States is causing to Cuba? So maybe they didn't choose to have this ecological footprint, but we still could use them as an example. Like if we want to live sustainable in the world, And with high development, human development, maybe we would end up living like in a similar lifestyle as people live in Cuba nowadays. Another topic that is related to the ecological footprint is what we call Earth Overshoot Day. It was formerly known as Earth Death Day, and it's a little bit this idea, like if we think about all the resources that our planet can produce for us in 1 year, when would be the time in this year that we would reach all the resources that the planet could bring to us? And after that, we are already in debt. We are already consuming more than the planet can produce to us. So it calculates like the total Earth biocapacity divided by the global footprint of all humanity. And then you divide it by the days of the year to find the exact day. So in this graph, we show, for example, in the 70s, we still could live our whole year within what the planet produced to us. But then it's after that, it started to be earlier, like December, November, October, September. So every time, like we reach a point when it would be already the limit of the planet, and it's going lower every year. Not in 2020 here. And why? Well, at 2020, we have the COVID pandemics, when we reduced a lot the consumption of natural resources, that we reduced a lot of the pollution because people were living in social isolation. There were the economy was stopped a lot too. So it was halting a lot of things. Even the production of energy decreased a lot because people were not consuming so much. So it increased. But then afterwards, in 2021, it already went to the similar levels as before. So probably we will keep in this trend of going downwards. And then like at each year, at this exactly day that we cross the limit of the planet, there is a kind of event in many places of the world, like kind of synced. We have protests, we have manifestations, and especially like during pandemics, we have like this kind of live online events that try to bring more awareness to people about how we are crossing the limits of our planet. And just to show a different kind of footprint, we have many kinds of footprints published in many places. One is water footprint, that is the amount of water that in average people consume in the world. And we have here the darker places are the places that consume more water per person. And the lightest ones, blue ones, are the places where consuming less water per person. And just to show that we can make this kind of calculation in many kinds of natural resource usage. Of course, I think it goes a little bit away from what we could call footprint, because footprint is on land, the original idea in nature. And this one is cubic meters. But this kind of calculation is interesting to bring awareness to people about how much water they are using to. And we can think about how much water is available in each country and make all this kind of reasoning that we made for the ecological footprint. So as an activity for you, I would like you to access this website, the footprintcalculators.org. It's the most famous footprint calculator in the world. And it's used as a kind of tool to increase environmental awareness at individual level. And usually there are many questions. I will ask you to answer them. And usually there is a kind of option like add details. So if possible, try to add all the details too, to be more like credible what the result in the end. And I'm showing here for me the result that I got, that I'm using. If everyone in the world would keep the same lifestyle as me, we would need 2.4. And my overshoot day in the year would be June 2nd. And there is also details like what kind of land use, like is in the ecological footprint. And for carbon, that was the highest one for me. And for you to produce food, and also for this different kind of activities that we do, like food, mobility, and services and other kinds. And some details that it gives to us that you can enter in more detail later. Then I would like you to crop the results. And also I add some reflection about would it be possible to decrease your ecological footprint? Why? Yes or no? And if yes, like how could you do that? The idea is to make you reflect on the individual scale, since we already discussed more at global scale, country scale, and then it would be important for us to think about what each person can do individually to enact local too. Okay? So finally, as a general reflection, I would like you to think like, give your opinion. Based on what we saw through all our course so far, and especially in this class regarding the sustainable indicator, do you think that human society is moving towards sustainable development? And why? Like yes or no? Why yes, why not? What could be done differently? What is your general idea so far? So this is the end of our class. And if you have any question or comment, you can enter in contact with us. And we see you in the next moments of our course. See you. Bye-bye.